This is Duke University.
So my name is Patrick Othout. I'm a sophomore, double majoring in public policy and philosophy. And on behalf of the Duke Colloquium, I'd like to welcome you here. I'd also like to welcome special guest Dr. Andrew Huang, founder and sponsor of the Duke Colloquium, now in its second year of implementation, as well as other members of the Duke Colloquium Advisory Board who are able to join us. After the lecture, Dr. David Malone will moderate the question and answer time. Dr. Malone is an associate professor of the practice in the program in education and the faculty director for Duke's Service Learning Program with the mission of connecting civic engagement to the curriculum. His research interests include tutoring of at-risk children, student-centered approaches to instruction, and experiential and service learning. The Duke Colloquium exists to inspire students and faculty to think in a more global and interdisciplinary way about the practice of their professions. Ultimately, the Duke Colloquium expects to host 2 to 3 events each year, bringing in internationally known thinkers and leaders to engage with the campus and larger community through interactive formats, all towards the end of helping to transform the practice of the professions for the betterment of society and mankind. The Duke Colloquium is distinct in its multi-event interactive format, as well as in its student leadership focus. The colloquium's first series last spring hosted Dr. Leon Botstein, president of Bard College. The current series has its honorary guest, Dr. Howard Gardner. Dr. Gardner is a John H. and Elizabeth A. Hobbs Professor of Cognition and Education at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. He grew up in Scranton, Pennsylvania. The first in his family to attend college, he earned a bachelor's degree in social relations at Harvard. As a Harvard Fellow at the London School of Economics, he spent a postgraduate year reading philosophy and sociology and then returned to Harvard, where he earned his PhD in developmental psychology in 1971. Among numerous honors, Gardner has received a MacArthur Genius Prize Fellowship, 26 honorary degrees from universities all over the world, and in 2005 and again in 2008, Foreign Policy and Prospect magazines named him among the world's 100 most influential public intellectuals. The Wall Street Journal named him one of the top 5 influential business thinkers, a group that includes journalists Tom Friedman and Malcolm Gladwell, as well as philanthropist and former Microsoft CEO Bill Gates. Many of you know him for his theory of multiple intelligences, first advanced 28 years ago, that countered the idea of a single human intelligence that could be measured with a tool such as standardized IQ. This revolutionary idea has had a profound effect on the way we think about human capabilities. It created a change in the methods we use to measure human capacity to think, learn, and create. Since the mid-1900s, he has directed the Good Work Project, a comprehensive study of his work that is excellent, engaging, and ethical. He is also investigating the nature of trust in contemporary society and the ethical dimensions that go along with the use of new digital media. In his most recent book, Truth, Beauty, and Goodness Reframed, Educating of the Virtues for the 21st Century, Dr. Gardner explores the meaning of the title's 3 virtues in an age when vast technological advancement and relativistic attitudes towards human nature have deeply shaken our moral worldview. He concludes that although these concepts are changing faster than ever before, they are and will remain, with our stewardship, cornerstones of our society. The topic we will address today is the minds that we should cultivate in the 21st century. Time will be reserved for your questions after the lecture. Now, I realize some students have class at 1:15, so if any students need to depart at 1:12, feel free to do so. So please join me in welcoming our guest for the Duke Colloquium second series, Dr. Howard Gardner.
Thank you, Patrick, and good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me? Am I audible back there? No. Is this better? Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm very pleased to be one of the first invited guests for the Duke Colloquium. It's a very interesting idea. It's a novel idea. And one of the ways in which it's interesting and novel is to look at the audience, because we have people here from all age groups and different parts of the university. And that means that any attempt that I made to target my talk for a particular audience is doomed to fail. So what I'm going to do is give you a fairly straightforward talk based on a book that I wrote some years ago with as I said to Dr. Huang, one slide directly focused on the Duke Colloquium. But the whole purpose of coming here, and I began working this morning at 8:30 with Dr. Robert Thompson's freshman seminar, and I'll be doing things throughout the next 2 days, is to have a chance to have a dialogue. So I'm going to be watching the clock and leave a lot of time for Q&A, and people are welcome to bring up anything you want. Can't promise I'll be able to answer it, but if you're here and interested in multiple intelligences or what Mitt Romney is really like, you know, I actually don't know him. But I lived in Belmont where he lived. Anyway, so that's the topic. Here's the plan. I'm going to start with a disclaimer, spend most of the time talking about these five minds, and then talking a bit about how they might be affected by the digital era, because even though the book was written about 6 or 7 years ago, at the time it was written, Twitter didn't exist, Facebook was a glint in Mark Zuckerberg's eye, and things are changing so quickly that if you have an analysis, you want to make sure you're not too far behind the times. So what's the disclaimer? Well, I'm best known for the theory of multiple intelligences, which claims that rather than having a single intelligence, people have a number of different intelligences, and your strength in one doesn't predict strength or weakness in the other. And I think there are 8 or 9 intelligences. So when some people heard about my interest in five minds, being very astute mathematically, they said, oh, Howard, you've dropped some of your intelligences. That was not correct. I am, for the most part, a psychologist. And when I introduced the idea of different intelligences, this was a hypothesis designed to challenge the notion of intellect being singular. And the ultimate fate of this theory was really based on the evidence that will accrue in going forward. When I talk about minds for the future, this is not a scientific claim. It's also not a futurist claim. It's my best analysis of what I think is important in the 21st century. So it's not five minds for the future is not an edited version of multiple intelligences. So that's the disclaimer. If I'm talking about the future, what do I have in mind? I have in mind principally 4 different forces. They're familiar to everybody in this room, but I just think I should put them out on the table so you know what I mean when I'm speaking about the future. One is, of course, globalization, the emergence of cities and megacities to which people flock for many reasons. Of course, brands that are also transcend the globe, trademarks, icons, fashions, and the like. Money, about $1 trillion circulates around the world every day, and what happens in any part of the world immediately affects other parts of the world. Any of you who read old novels or histories will know that, you know, a century or so ago, if something happened in one place, it took a long time for people to hear it in other places. I'm told that when Princess Diana died, within a day, 98% of the world knew about that. When Lehman Brothers collapsed in September of 2008, being pretty ignorant about financial things, I didn't understand why there were repercussions all over the world, because when the market crashed in 1929, it took really years for the depression to spread. When I learned that Lehman Brothers had contracts with 8,000 different companies all around the world, it made globalization much more vivid to me. There's the biological revolution, what we're learning about the brain, what we're learning about genetics. And if you ask me today, in 2012, how much about what we know about the brain and about genetics should really affect what we do in education, I would give an honest answer and say probably in dealing with certain problems like dyslexia, the knowledge is useful, but it probably doesn't affect very much what goes on in a college or university campus like Duke, but I have no doubt whatsoever that over the coming years, the more we know about how brains work in general, the more we know about how your brain works, similarly with genetics, the more the life of the mind will be affected by biological knowledge. And at Harvard, where I teach, I'm involved with the Mind, Brain, and Behavior Initiative and the Mind, Brain, and Education Initiative, because we're all quite certain that education will not be immune from biological knowledge. Of course, everybody talks about the digital revolution, the emergence of virtual realities like Second Life, multi-user games, which involve millions of players. And even though I thought it was mostly teenagers and mostly males, in fact, all the statistics show that games are quite gender neutral. Women play games as much as men, and the age goes up. It's now as common among 30-year-olds, who I guess were teenagers once, than it is among teens. Of course, the world is composed of two kinds of people: people who belong to Facebook and liars. And there are two kinds of people: people who admit to going first to Wikipedia and people who don't tell the truth. And of course, nobody heard of Twitter 2 or 3 years ago, but probably this talk is being tweeted as I speak, and that's fine with me. So the digital world is here. In fact, probably within a few years, people won't even talk about online and offline anymore, because they're so fused now that it's only digital immigrants like me who still make a fairly sharp distinction. In fact, I'm staying at the Washington Duke Inn, is that what it's called? And I noticed that the student newspaper is still produced on paper. And I wondered whether anybody reads it on paper, because certainly my children don't read paper anymore, but maybe you guys still do. Intelligent machines, robots. This is important because as robots get to do things which human beings used to do, which includes childcare and care of the aged and so on, this has enormous employment implications, as I'm sure you know. This is lifelong learning. This is me and my classmates, not you guys. But the notion that education would end in high school, which was what the case was in the early part of the 20th century, and then in the middle of the 20th century, that education would end after college and university, is just completely anachronistic now. Anybody who is active in any field continues to learn throughout their lives, or they become anachronistic very quickly. You can learn with others, you can be an autodidact, but certainly education continues throughout life. And I don't know the statistics, but certainly in the United States and other developed countries, more and more of education is not with the 18 to 22-year-old group, but continuing through life. So that's the future, the four factors that I think are going to basically revolutionize the way we think about cognition, mentation, and so on. So here's the five minds, and that's a book cover of the book in which I describe these minds. But the structure of the rest of the talk is basically to talk us through each of them. The first mind is the one that's most familiar to educational institutions and most familiar to your ancestors, and that's the discipline mind. And I use the word discipline here with three connotations. The first, which everybody knew for many, many generations, that you need to work on things steadily if you're going to get better at them. Nobody doubts that's true, but it may be harder now for reasons I'll talk about later. But that's one meaning of the word discipline. The second one, actually third on the slide, is mastering the major ways of thinking that human beings have developed. Particularly at the pre-university level, I think there are four that should be prioritized: thinking historically, thinking artistically, thinking scientifically, thinking mathematically. Once you get to older populations, of course, many other fields, but I think those are, to me, the most important ones at the pre-collegiate level. And then, this I was alluding to before, in the 19th century, people farmed or they worked in factories. In the 20th century, they worked in factories or corporations. But now, as long as they didn't screw up, they were pretty confident that they would have a job. But nowadays, as everybody in this room knows, if you are just capable of routine work, you're going to get replaced sooner or later by some kind of technology. And so the third meaning of discipline is becoming an expert in something. Because only if you're an expert, only if you're, so to speak, one step ahead of the technology, are you going to be assured of some kind of a reasonable life career set of options. And since one of the notions of the colloquium is becoming a professional means becoming an expert, becoming disciplined in at least one thing. We could talk later about interdisciplinary or transdisciplinary kinds of things. One other slide on disciplines. A lot of Americans, including ones who make up tests, confuse disciplines with subject matter. Subject matter is knowing stuff, like when was the Battle of Waterloo, or you know, what are the four components of genetic code. But for the four, you know, adenine and guanine and that stuff. But you can look all that stuff up now on your handheld. Subject matter is knowing lots of stuff. Disciplines is knowing how historians think, how scientists think, how different kinds of scientists think. That's what we haven't learned yet how to transmit in some kind of a smart device. And that's why you go to school and work with people who do think historically or think scientifically and learn from them. The important thing, which I didn't write about in Five Minds for the Future, but is a major theme of the more recent book on Truth, Beauty, and Goodness Reframed, is that what we're really learning when we learn disciplines are the methods that people use. So how does a historian figure out what really happened? How does he or she make use of written materials, digital materials, interviews, videos, whatever? How does a scientist go about his or her work? What's the role of theory? What's the role of models? What's the role of experiments? What's the role of replications? Michael Polanyi, who is a famous philosopher, said, this is 1950, so it's a long time ago, he said, you could read about science living in India all your life, but it wouldn't replace 3 weeks in a scientific laboratory in London. And he was right. Now, of course, in the digital world, that may not be as true. But really, it's learning the methods that's what's key to being a disciplined person. And in a time with information glut, knowing why it is that a person asserts what he or she asserts, how do they come about to those conclusions, to those claims, that's really what you learn when you are a disciplined person. That's Charles Darwin. I quipped this morning, you're not allowed to show his picture below the Mason-Dixon line, but there's a special exception for the research triangle. You're allowed to, they don't inspect you at the airport to see if you have. I love Darwin. One reason I love Darwin, I never said this publicly, is he's the only creative genius that I studied who was actually a nice person. All we know about Darwin, he was a decent human being. You can ask me about that later. But the reason I have Darwin up here is because he is the epitome of the synthesizing mind. What is a synthesizing mind? The synthesizing mind is one which takes huge amounts of information and organizes it so that the person himself can understand it and so that he or she can communicate the synthesis to somebody else. And you know what Darwin did. He was a decent student, but he wasn't as smart as the others in his family. So they put him on a boat for 5 years called the Beagle. He traveled around the globe. He collected flora and fauna of all sorts. And then he spent 20 years thinking about it, communicating with all of the naturalists in the developed world, raising pigeons and orchids and studying coral reefs. And then he laid out, in a big book, but in a set of very simple laws, the principles of evolution which undergird all of biology and increasingly are used in every other discipline as well. I would add sometimes not terribly appropriately, but that's not Darwin's fault. He's been dead for a long time. So knowing how to synthesize is incredibly important now. I thought that psychology, my field, and the field of some of yours, would kind of tell us how to synthesize. But in fact, when I wrote this book, I found very little information on synthesis in the psychological literature. So I began to think about what's involved in synthesizing. And probably the best quick analogy is the term paper. Probably everybody here who goes to a school, anything like the kind of school I went to, has to write a term paper. You know, the causes of the French Revolution, or you know, how did we discover that diseases are caused by microorganisms. And when you write a synthesis, or when you deliver a synthesis orally, or you create some kind of a media production, you need to know what other people have already done. You need to know the form and shape of the synthesis you want to produce. You need to do it enough time so you can get some feedback, both from people who know a lot and from people who know even less than you do. But the key thing about the synthesis, again, is method. How do you go about taking all that stuff, whether it's biological stuff the way Darwin was making sense of it, you know, different kinds of plants and animals, or whether it's economic data, of which we're all drowning because there's so much data collected nowadays, or sports for that matter, you know, the money game, is that what it's called? What? Moneyball, right, the Michael Lewis book. You know, and you need to have methods. And I think what's bad is if I am a synthesizer and I say everybody has to synthesize, this is a tongue twister, everybody has to synthesize in the same way. But there are many ways to synthesize. I happen to be a nut about taxonomies. I love to create taxonomies. But it would be terrible if I took the 50 or 75 people in this room and said, you all have to create taxonomies. You've got to synthesize in the way that makes sense for you. And I listed a whole bunch of ways in which people synthesize. Now, even though some of you are pretty young, you all know what books are, right? probably no two people organize books in exactly the same way. And it doesn't matter, as long as you can find the cookbook when you need it, or you can find the comic book when you need it, or you can find the medical dictionary when you need it. And it's the same way as synthesize. So I think teachers should make many ways of synthesis available, and I'm sure that the internet also provides many organizing schema. So that's the second mind. The third mind is the creating mind. This is, of course, everybody knows Einstein from photographs, and many people know Virginia Woolf from photographs. What's interesting is that everybody knows Einstein would look like this, but of course he did his creative work 50 years ago. So if you're going to be a 50 years before, so if you want to be a scientist, you got to make your creativity when you're young. Artists can create a long time, though you can't do what Virginia Woolf did, which is kill herself and continue producing. Einstein lived longer. But what's the creating mind? The creating mind, everybody in this room knows, is the mind that can think outside the box. And especially at a time when anything that's formulaic will be done by machine, it's very, very important to think outside of the box. But the important thing is you can't think outside of the box unless you have a box. And the box is the disciplines and the synthesis that you've done. Nobody wakes up, this I never said this, but nobody wakes up as Mozart. Even Mozart had to compose for 10 years before anybody was interested in his music, except his father. And Picasso, similarly, those are the two great prodigies of the Western world. They each started when they were 5, so by the time they were 15, they were damn good. But you have to develop that box first. How many of you have read the new book, Imagine, by Jonah Lehrer. Well, nobody yet, but you will, because it's number one on the bestseller list. And he gets ads in the paper the rest of us can only dream about. I think it's a good book. In fact, I confess to you, it's better than I hoped it would be. That's. I don't know whether we want to allow that to be shown in the video. But I think one of the reasons that I didn't think it was going to be that good is because the reason people buy a book called Imagine, and the subtitle has the word creative in it, is because they want the magic formula for being creative. And what I think Lehrer doesn't emphasize enough is you still have to work on stuff for 10 years before you can be expert enough. I mean, even people like Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerberg, who, you know, we became very wealthy early in life, they were still programming stuff for 10 years. It doesn't happen without that. So you need the box, you need the discipline, you need the synthesizing, but start when you're young. Because then you got more years to do new stuff. As a person trained in cognitive studies, I thought before I began to study the creating mind, that it was mostly about intellect, it was mostly about computation, it was mostly about cognition. And of course, that's true, but what I didn't realize was that at least as important as the kind of personality and temperament that you have. If you want to be somebody who is considered creative, somebody who's considered innovative, somebody who's considered having a good imagination, you have to be willing to take chances. You have to be willing to try something out. If it doesn't work, you can be annoyed, but you don't give up. You don't kick the dog. You try something else. And in my studies of creativity, the most impressive line that I heard, which means my kids have now heard it 10,000 times, is from Jean Monnet, who was the French economist who came up with the idea of the European Union easily 50 years ago. Jean Monnet said, "I regard every defeat as an opportunity." And this notion that when something goes wrong and it can be classified as the defeat, if you think about it instead as an occasion for learning, that is the key to having a creating mind and a creating disposition. The one place where the West, which is basically the United States, Europe, and places like Australia, which are influenced by Europe, had an advantage until about 30, 40 years ago, was in this willingness to take a chance, make mistakes, and fall flat in your face and not give up. In Asia, particularly Confucian societies, learning was done step by step so that you would never make an error. And error-free learning is great if you're going to do well in a certain kind of test. It's a disaster if you're going to try to do something new. I used to tell a wisecrack that 30 years ago, people would come to see me at my office at Harvard from Singapore or Taiwan or Korea or Japan, and they'd say, "Dr. Gardner, you're an expert in creativity. Please give us the 23 steps in order for being creative," and write them down. And of course, you know, you're lost if that's the idea. Now, happily, that's not true anymore. You can be anywhere in the world. You know, half the innovators in Silicon Valley come from India, and I don't have to justify China or Japan or Taiwan. You know, these countries are fine now, but that's because the secret of taking chances is now not a secret anymore. But for a long time, it was the big advantage that Europe and countries influenced by Europe had, which Confucian societies didn't have. I'm sure Dr. Huang and I could have a long discussion about that topic. So that's the creating mind. You all know about the elevator speech, which you have to master nowadays. So if somebody says to you, "Well, what are the first three minds that Gardner talked about?" The answer is depth, breadth, and stretch. Depth is discipline, going deeply into things, mastering them. Synthesis is breadth, learning about all the different sources of information that are relevant and trying to put them together. And creating a stretch, it's going beyond where others have gone. It's going into the unknown. It's frightening, but it can also be exhilarating. The last 15 years of my life, I've been working on two other kinds of minds, which are not cognitive in the usual sense. Actually, when he was introducing me, Patrick said, since the middle of the last century. It wasn't quite that long ago. Since the middle of the 1990s, I've been working on issues of respect and ethics. And those are minds, but they aren't minds in the computational sense that we think about disciplines and synthesizing and creating. So the respectful mind's pretty easy to put into words, though that doesn't mean it's easy to achieve. The respectful mind recognizes that just as we look different from one another, we have different personalities, different belief systems, different ethnicities, different religions, and we can either kill each other, and there's a long tradition of doing that, or we can try to hide in our foxhole and not see anybody else, or we can be tolerant but keep our distance. But the respectful mind, as it says, goes beyond tolerance. It accepts diversity, it welcomes it, and it makes efforts to try to understand individuals and groups and institutions which are different from our own. And it is in tension with what I call the top-down model where, as the next slide says, you kiss up but kick down. That means if somebody has more power than you have, you're very nice to them and you flatter them. But if somebody doesn't have power over you or you have some influence over them, you don't give them the time of day. So one of the opponents of respect is this kind of hierarchical notion. A respectful person treats people as if their background and the amount of money they have and the amount of power they have is not the basis on which the relationship is based. So it involves a lot of going against evolution, so to speak. Again, we could talk a lot about that. It's telling jokes about groups. I certainly have done that. I've certainly laughed at jokes about groups. But it's not a good idea if you want to build a respectful society. Also, you don't want to respect people only if they fulfill a whole bunch of conditions. I mean, this doesn't mean if Hitler walked in the room that he's worthy of respect. I think he's forfeited that. But respect has to have a certain degree of charity connected to it. And if people misbehave, but they want to enter into forgiveness, then that means that you should try to respect them. And that's what the commissions on peace and reconciliation are about. They're in many countries all around the world. And you bring victims and victimizers together, and you try to understand what happens. The victimizers try to indicate that they've turned a new leaf, that they are worthy of forgiveness. And then the most successful societies move on, because it's not good. We have somebody here from the former Yugoslavia. It's not good when you're fighting battles over hundreds of years. It's nice if you can put that in the past. And so there are efforts in the arts, in music, in athletics. I just read a very interesting paper, actually, by a student at Tufts on whether the New York Philharmonic should have gone to play in North Korea some years ago. Some of you remember that. And it's an effort of artistic diplomacy. My notion is it couldn't possibly have done any harm, and maybe it did some good. And so one thing to think about is how do you establish a respectful institutional culture, especially if there are lots of messages which are quite disrespectful. I'll talk a lot more about that at the end of the talk. So that's the respectful mind. The ethical mind is the one that I will spend more time on than the others, because the way I think about it is not the way everybody else does. I wouldn't want to have to diagram that sentence. I'm not the only person who thinks about it this way, but it's not the way everybody thinks about it. But it's very important for the work that the Duke Colloquium is doing on the professions. When I talk about ethics, I'm talking about something that's more abstract than respect. Every two-year-old can see whether adults are respectful to one another, whether kids are respectful to another. When you are thinking ethically, you have to see yourself in a role. And the two roles I'm interested in is your role as a worker and your role as a citizen. Only by a stretch of metaphor can we talk about young people as being workers or citizens. Until I was 15 or so, I was Howard or Howie. That's who I was. But when you move to later adolescence and young adulthood, you begin to enter a profession of one sort or another. You're a doctor, or you're an engineer, or you're an architect, or you're a teacher. And the ethical mind wrestles with what does it mean to do professional work well. Similarly, you always live in the neighborhood. You always have people who live next door. If you move around, you meet other people. But as you get older, you become a citizen. You're all now, I believe, citizens of Duke or of some other educational institution near here. You're citizens of the state. You're citizens of the country. And we're all citizens of the world now. And it's not just a trite phrase. If you have a sickness and you go in an airplane and you bring it to another part of the world, it's a communicable disease, you're being a bad citizen. If you insist on using gas guzzlers, which use huge amounts of carbon, and you're oblivious to what that does to the environment, you're not being a good citizen, in my definition. And so the ethical mind is not one that just talks about rights. Americans are great at talking about rights. The ethical mind talks about responsibilities. And one of the messages of Duke generally nowadays is people who are connected with institutions have a lot of privileges. What are the responsibilities that go with those privileges? Your responsibility as worker, your responsibility of a citizen. That's what my work and my colleagues' work on good work and good citizenship is about. So what is good work? This definition is in part a definition, but it's empirically based because we interviewed over 1,200 people in 9 different professions throughout the United States to try to understand their understanding of good work. And good work consists of 3 properties, each of which conveniently begin with the letter E. It's technically excellent. It's disciplined. The person knows what he or she is doing, and other people in that field say, oh, yes, he or she is a competent physician or teacher or journalist or whatever. Good work is engaged. The person likes the work, wants to do it, looks forward to Monday, doesn't dread it. It's too difficult to do good work if you feel disengaged, if you feel alienated. The third aspect of good work, which is what I've been focusing on, it's carried out in an ethical way. The good worker tries to be responsible, tries to do the right thing in a situation, not just the thing that serves himself or herself's own interest. Obviously, each of these things isn't completely self-evident. Excellence can be debated. Engagement is not something you can judge of others. They have to indicate it themselves, so you can look for clues. And ethics is a very complicated issue. But we have created this visual. It's 3 E's. We call this the triple helix, or ENA, in contradistinction to DNA. And you think about yourself, think about people you know. You can ask, are they a good worker? So let's take education, since everybody here knows about teaching. A teacher can be well-informed, but not particularly engaged, or highly engaged, but not particularly informed, or informed and engaged, but not particularly ethical, or sadly, could be very ethical, but not know what he or she's doing. So not that I have anybody in mind, but it's intertwining these 3 E's, which is the essence of good work. So I said there was a slide about the Duke Colloquium. You can do good work in any sphere, from being a artist, to being a business person, to being a person in the service industries. But good work, I believe, is particularly connected with professions. Why? Because professions are people who get training, get licensed, are expected to follow a high ethical standard. And in each profession, there are guidelines about what it means to be ethical or not ethical. Alas, they aren't typically enforced, which means that the profession loses its claim to legitimacy. But professionals, and probably everybody in this room is more or less in that sphere, are people who are given a certain amount of status and a certain amount of respect on the assumption that they will be able to make complex decisions under conditions of uncertainty. We don't go anymore to a professional to do something for which there's a perfectly good app. Nor should we. We go to lawyers or doctors or educators when we have difficult issues where we can't just push a button and get an answer or click a mouse and say, help me think about it. Draw on your wisdom, draw on your knowledge, draw on your experience, draw on the context to try to give me, try to give us the best solution to this particular dilemma. What are liberal arts and humanities? One of the major reasons for not simply studying the profession itself is it's only if you have a rather broad range of experience, knowing about different people, different cultures, different histories, can you make the best kind of advice and judgment on a complex situation. I'm sure there are many medical situations where, you know, a simple test will tell you what to do. We no longer need professionals for that. It's when you have, you know, a complicated cancer and you're a certain kind of person from a certain kind of population and the treatments are changing monthly, that's where you need that kind of complex judgment. And the broader your experience, the more you can think philosophically, the more you can think psychologically, the more you can draw on history, the more likely you are to come up with the best possible solution for that problem, and to lay out even the options. And that's why we're incredibly privileged in the United States, because we do have a liberal arts tradition, whereas in every other country, people go right to the professions once they finish secondary school, and they lack that liberal arts tradition, unless they get it in secondary school, which in some countries they clearly do. And that's a lack in our country, is that often liberal arts only begins for earnest when you start college, unless you're lucky enough to go to a very privileged secondary school, more often private than public, where the liberal arts are foregrounded. Again, discipline, not just subject matter. Then, this is a particular thing that I'm thinking about now. I'm writing a paper, it's about half written, called In Defense of Disinterestedness in the Digital Era. For short, I call it D3, Defense, Disinterestedness, Digital. Most people haven't heard the word disinterested, and some people think it means not interested. But disinterested, if you go to the dictionary, actually means the ability to put your own interests aside and to try to think about things in a broader, more cosmic way. And to me, that is the essence of a professional, is that he or she, of course, has interests and values. We all do. But the advice and decisions and actions that professionals carried out are not simply designed to pursue their own agenda. So if you're a reporter, you can have tremendously strong feelings about something. But a reporter, your job is to tell things the way they are and not the way you'd like them to be. And I can go through all the professions with that in mind. So that's an aside for the Duke Colloquium. We studied good work for about 10 years. We interviewed, as I said, many subjects in many areas. And we did study with young people, which was quite disturbing. And this was youth, the age of the young people here, the age of my children. And the picture we got was not very positive, but we're not blaming the kids. The people to blame are ourselves, because kids weren't born this way. This was the world in which they grew up in. What we heard from young people over and over again is they knew what good work was, they admired it, and some of them really strove to do good work. But over and over again, we heard the same thing. There have now been dozens of studies from different disciplines which reinforce this. What kids were telling us was, we want to be good workers someday. We want to set a model of good work. We want to hire good workers. We want to discriminate between people who are ethical and engaged and those who are not. But we don't think we can do good work now, because we want to achieve something in our lives. We want to be able to have power and wealth and success. And we don't think that our peers are on the straight and narrow. We think they're cutting corners. And we're going to be damned if they get those rewards that we want. So give us a pass for now, and someday we'll redeem ourselves. So at this point, I quote St. Augustine, who was not a classmate of mine, but St. Augustine said, "O Lord, make me chaste, but not yet." And what we learned from these young people, and you know, they're our kids and love them, and they're you, the young people here, and it's the world you grew up in. You didn't come up with this way, this attitude on your own. So the next slide, which tells you what I've been doing with high school kids, with college kids at different schools, just began actually working at Stanford, is to try to raise consciousness about good work issues at a young age, so that when you go to the workplace and when you go to the voting booth, you already are beginning to think about these issues of ethics. Let me just give you one example, because it's vivid and everybody gets into it. Debbie, and these are all true stories. I actually heard a wonderful true story today in Dr. Thompson's class, but I don't have permission to cite it yet, but maybe I'll get permission. So Debbie is a junior in high school. She's editor of the newspaper. She's a great journalist, and her grandfather was a famous reporter for the New York Times. There's a rape on campus, and as a good reporter, she is going to cover the rape in the newspaper. The head of the school calls her in and says, "You can't report the rape in the newspaper because next week we're recruiting for the school, and if people think that there's a rape on campus, they aren't going to come to school. So I forbid you to do it." So she's in a quandary. She's a journalist. Her grandfather's a famous journalist. There's a rape on campus. Let's pretend there's no Twitter. So people need to know that there might be a rapist that's still around. So she is a quandary because the head of school says you can't do it. So she goes home and she tells her mother, and her mother gives her a big hug and says, "It's wonderful. I'm so proud of you. Grandpa would be so proud of you. You really understand journalism. But your brother Teddy wants to go to school next year. And if you go against the headmaster, he's not going to get in, and you really want to have that on you." So these are the kind of dilemmas which come up all the time. And when we interviewed professionals and they said they never had any ethical dilemmas, I was thinking to myself, you are clueless, because they come up all the time, and that's why an interest in liberal arts, ethics, and the professions is a very good focus for a college or university. Why is WikiLeaks up here? I don't know. No, the reason it's up here is just like the story of Debbie is a great thing to get people to talk about work, WikiLeaks is a great people to talk about citizenship. Was WikiLeaks a good thing? Was it a bad thing? There's no easy answer, right? So the idea that I'm beginning to try to promulgate, though I have to confess I have not been successful yet at my own university, is that we need to create common spaces. They can be physical like this, or they can be online, because everybody has access online, where people can reflect on the kinds of dilemmas that I described. And the story with Debbie can be increased a millionfold. Dilemmas come up every day for every professional about what people do, whether they could have done it better. When you have almost any ethical dilemma, it's useful to talk to other people. It's particularly useful to talk to other people in the field, because they've been there before. And because of online, it's much easier to do it now than ever would have been before. So here's something you to think about. Maybe you have a commons at Duke, but I'd be surprised if you do. But how could you set one up? What would be good? What could be bad? Can it be done? Can it be done in cyberspace? A dean at Harvard said to me, "I wouldn't do it unless I could do it face to face." But she was of a certain age, and maybe that's no longer a consideration. But maybe you do have to do it face to face. So these are things that I think about. So I said I was going to say something about Five Minds and Digital Age. I'm going to keep it very short because I'd like to have time for questions. One, there's so many interesting things going on now that the notion of working steadily at things every day to get better may be more difficult in a digital era. You need to be able to discipline yourself more. School used to be the most interesting thing in town. Now it's not. In fact, all over the world, my colleague Marcelo Suarez Orozco reports, if you give students a sentence completion task, school is, what's the answer, class? Boring, right. Synthesis, the wonderful thing now is we have more information available than ever before. And that means we can more likely to figure out what's true than ever before. Except in North Korea, everything is known. But how do we put it together? That's the challenge. And will there be apps to help us? And will those apps be Procrustean? Will they limit us? Or will they be liberating? Creativity, we're actually writing a book on this topic. Are we in the dawn of a Florentine era of creativity with Web 2.0, 3.0, and so on, meaning there can be more creativity in every sphere than ever before? Or one of the things we've been finding in our research is that young people now in America, we're just working in America, tend to be risk averse, that they're very much afraid of deviating from some path. And we could talk about why. I think there's some very good reasons why. But you know, as I said earlier, if you're not willing to fall flat on your face and go outside the pack, the chances whether you'll be creative are not high. And on respect and ethics, I have nothing new to say about morality. Morality, if you read the Ten Commandments and the Golden Rule, it tells you how to deal with people in your world, what I call neighborly morality. And I don't think that idea has changed in a long time. But the ethics of roles, particularly professional roles and citizen roles, are very new. And that's where the Bible and the Golden Rule will not tell you what to do. And that's why you need common kinds of spaces where you can talk about the kinds of new dilemmas that come up every day. In every profession I can think of, the very existence of technology has changed everything. What does it mean to have a jury when somebody can look up something or tweet somebody? You know, there's nothing in the Constitution that tells us about tweeting, right? So final comment, the figure ground struggle in education today. So this is a painting, right? So you wouldn't probably give it a second look, but it's a typical painting from a couple hundred years ago. The figure is the thing in the front. It's this child, and you focus on the figure, and the background helps you to focus on the figure, but you don't particularly focus on the background unless you happen to be an art historian. So the figure is the stuff that stands out. Here's the thing that I think about. Nowadays, in the United States and in many other parts of the world, the figure in education is how do people do on tests? How do they do on the SAT? How do they do on the LSAT? How do they do on the PISA or the TIMSS? These are the international comparisons. And they become so dominant that they tend to quash everything else. And I think the figure should be, and having heard me for the last half hour, you won't be surprised, it should not be test scores. It should be the kinds of people we want to nurture and the kind of society that we want to have. Some of you will know there was a book called The Best and the Brightest. It came out in the 1970s. It was about, no, probably the 1980s. It was about the Vietnam War. And it was about people from my university, Harvard, and other places like Harvard, who went to Washington and basically started the Vietnam War and couldn't get out of it. George Bush thinks we won the Vietnam War, but he's the only person who thinks that. Notion of the best and the brightest is people can do very well in tests and rankings and have no moral compass at all. And when people attack public education in America and teachers and principals, I always say, well, what caused the 2001, the 2008 financial meltdown? Was it the kids in the schools? No, it was people who went to Harvard and went to Wall Street and made obscene amounts of money and had no particular concern about how anybody else was affected. So there's a reason why I'm making this comment here while I'm your impolite guest. I think that it's very important at elite schools like the one I'm at and the one you're at that we don't let accountings and rankings dominate. And to the extent that they contribute to having the individuals we want to nurture and the societies we want to live in, it's good. But to the extent that they detract from that, it's very bad. So closing thoughts from two wise Americans. Martin Luther King Jr. said intelligence plus character, that's the goal of true education. The first three minds are more about intelligence. The last two minds, respect and ethics, about a character. This is Ralph Waldo Emerson as portrayed on a Barnes & Noble shopping bag. Another vanishing feature, I'm afraid, book bags. And he said character is more important than intellect. And I hope that that's something that will become part of the Duke Colloquium conversation going forward. So that's it. If you want to learn more about the Good Work Project, those are some websites. And David's going to be the question.
Well, first of all, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I think if we employ your definition of good work, you have done good work here today. If we use the rubric of the triple E helix, you have met all those criteria. So thank you very much.
Produced by Duke University. Online at duke.edu.